Why did you decide to leave your job? You've been working beautifully, you have been receiving such a good salary in such a good organization. Why did you decide to leave and prepare for RBI?
So basically, working in Coal India gave me a lot of exposure and a lot of scope. But while working for Coal India, after 1 or 2 years, I realized that this is not the core area of my interest. And I really believe ki if I am not if I'm not pursuing what I like, I am doing injustice to the organization as well as to myself. Because I won't be able to give my best to the organizations and I won't be able to fulfill my capabilities as well. So
How do you
it was a
know
late decision. Yes, it was a late decision.
how do you know that you will be very good when functioning in RBI?
Yes, sir. For that, sir, first of all, when I realized that I am starting to develop interest in this sector, sir, just to be sure that whatever I am choosing is the right path for me, I just did a diploma in banking and finance. I got a diploma in that course, and then I realized that, yeah, I really have interest in this sector and I further like to explore the possibilities there. Then only, sir, gradually I started preparing for RBI. So it was a very conscious and a very well thought out decision, not in case.
ठीक है, परफेक्ट. जतिन, कैन यू टेल मी व्हाट वाज द मेजर रीजन बिहाइंड सेटिंग अप ऑफ रीजनल रूरल बैंक्स इन 1975?
So sir, the basic the two nationalizations prior to the banking that happened prior to the formations of RRBs were tried to fix the problem of credit lag in the credit disparities in the various sectors. The credit earlier were only given to the privileged section of the society, and the rural sector and the underprivileged sections were not given the adequate credit. After the two commercialization of the public sector, the banks, till the results were not up to the mark. So in order to fill the flux which was created, that low credit was in the rural sector, the government thought to create RRB. So basically that they tried to fix that disparity which was there, and they were trying to streamline the credit flow in the economy.
Okay, but cooperative banks were already working in rural areas by that time, and they were doing very well. They were serving the society very well, especially in rural areas. So why specifically another class of banks? What was the basic need behind creating another class of banks?
So, though cooperatives were there from a long time back, but cooperatives in general lacked professionalism as well as they were not very efficient in their working. There were a lot of lacuna there. So, in order to create a single structure which will have an efficient and a better penetration in the rural economy and to streamline the banking activity, because banking is a risky business and without proper rules and guidelines and without a proper regulating body for it, it becomes very difficult to make it a sustainable venture. So government wanted to professionalize it in a way and to make it a sustainable venture, because cooperatives though were there, but there were a lot of lacunas in that.
ठीक है, जतिन, कैन यू टेल मी द मेजर डिफरेंसेस बिटवीन स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक्स एंड पेमेंट बैंक्स?
So the biggest difference between a small finance bank and a payment bank is that payment bank can't lend, they can't give credit. A small finance bank can give credit. Payment bank can accept deposits up to 1 lakh, but only up to 1 lakh. But SFBs has no other limit. Payment bank is basically they don't have their physical branches. It is mostly via technological fintech, financial technology setup we have. Small finance bank in other have their physical branches, and they have a mandate that just 75% of the branches should be in the unbanked areas, and 50% of their credit should be with an amount less than 25 lakh. And small finance banks were given by Nachiket Mor committee. They were formed on the recommendation of Nachiket Mor committee, whereas payment banks were formed on the recommendation of Usha Thorat committee.
And what are the CRR and SLR requirements for both of these banks?
Okay, so CRR and SLR, they have to, the norms are same. A CAR of SFBs are 15%, whereas for payment bank it is 12%. But the CRR and SLR requirements are same. It is 4% and 18.25% as of now.
Okay, you're saying SLR requirement is 18.5% only for payment banks also.
SLR, yes, 18.25%, yes, sir.
Okay, fine. There are various conventional and unconventional monetary policy tools. Can you name some of both these classifications?
Okay. conventional and unconventional. Okay, sir. So the conventional monetary policy tools will be repo rate. It will be repo rate, reverse repo rate, MSF. These are the conventional monetary policy tools. Unconventional would be, sir, OMOs, the securities which government sells to curb out the liquidity.
Are OMOs unconventional or conventional?
I'm a bit confused in that. I didn't get the reference. I know in terms of quantitative and qualitative, but conventional and unconventional, I'm not getting right now in the head.
What are the other unconventional tools which have been used in reality over the past 4-5 years?
Last 4-5 years, I can't think of anything right now, sir.
Okay. Can you explain to me how negative interest rate policy works?
Negative interest rate policy, in sense, RBI doesn't follow that.
No, various other central banks have implemented negative interest rate policy.
Yes, sir. I read about it, sir, but I'm not very well aware about that. I read about it in Deutsche Bank follows that, but I'm not very well aware about how it functions.
Can you define to me very clearly what is financial inclusion?
Okay, so financial inclusion is basically a process in which a member of the society has knowledge about the various financial services that are available, knowledge as well as accessibility to the various financial services available to him, like banking, insurance, credit facilities. So if he has information as well as access to it, then he will be financially included.
So what are these components? You mentioned two, banking and insurance. Are these the only two services, or are there?
No, sir. There are other services, sir. Banking, there are insurance, there is then mutual fund services. There are many other services comes under it.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Since you've done diploma in banking and finance, you must have read about chit funds and nidhis.
Chit funds and, sir?
Nidhi.
Yeah, sir, I read a bit about it. Yeah, sir.
So what is the primary difference between these two methods of saving, chit funds as well as nidhis?
Sir, I am not very sure about the answer, but I'd like to try, if you permit.
Yes.
So chit funds are basically registered under the respective state act. And nidhi there is a separate act for a central act for a nidhi act. This is what I can remember, sir, currently. The chit funds is basically state specific.
Okay. Can you tell me what is an escrow account?
Escrow account is basically a third party account. For example, like if NABARD is giving a loan for RIDF fund, the two state government, then NABARD will not directly disperse the amount they're giving it to the account of the state government. Mm. They'll make a third party account for that respective project, and all the amount that has to be dispersed will be going through that account. So that kind of account is known as the escrow account.
Achha. In Basel III, there are certain pillars. So I'm asking you two questions. What are the major pillars in Basel III, number one? And second is, there is a ratio called as net stable funding ratio, which is used under Basel III in order to identify the position of banks. So what is the formula of net stable funding ratio, and what are the three pillars under Basel III?
Okay. So Basel III, first pillar will be the capital adequacy ratio. It has to be less than 9%, more than 9%. 8% is for the norm for that is given by Basel norms, but 9% is prescribed by RBI. And the second thing is the leverage ratio should be less than 3%. And the third pillar, I'm not getting it right now, sir. And NSFR, sir, I don't remember the formula of it. I won't be able to answer that.
Achha. There's another ratio called as liquidity coverage ratio. Can you explain to me what is liquidity coverage ratio?
So liquidity coverage ratio is basically in short term, whatever amount of liquidity that is required, the liquid funds that are required to meet the needs for the short amount, like for 30 days we take. So whatever liquid funds a company needs for its short-term needs, as the short-term cash needs, that is basically liquidity. So liquidity coverage ratio. So for 30 days, how much amount of liquid cash you need, that amount will be divided by the total amount that will give you actually the liquidity coverage ratio. It basically means you need how much amount you need to cover your liquidity for a specific period of time, a short specific period of time.
देखो जतिन अच्छा व्हेन इज योर फाइनल इंटरव्यू
28th
सो यू स्टिल हैव मोर देन 10 डेज यू हैव 11 डेज ओके सी योर इंटरव्यू इज गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद कोल इंडिया लिमिटेड मोस्ट प्रोबेबली दे गोइंग टू आस्क यू रीजंस ऑफ व्हाई यू लेफ्ट एंड व्हाई डू यू वांट टू जॉइन आरबीआई ओके बिकॉज़ ऑल्दो दे ऑलरेडी सी दैट यू हैव डन डिप्लोमा इन बैंकिंग एंड फाइनेंस दे वांट यू टू कनेक्ट इट ओके They might also directly ask with banking questions in case they already assume that, okay, you left Coal India Limited simultaneously, you did some diploma, and now you feel that you are interested in RBI. So they might just skip that part if they want to check directly how much do you know. Okay. In both the situations, they are going to come to the same situation, they are going to come to the same place, which is questions on banking, questions on finance.
Okay.
Because it says diploma in banking and finance. I asked you questions specifically on banking because I wanted to check that first. Okay. There are a lot of areas, to be very honest, where you need a lot of refinement. Okay. The questions, because the concepts are not very, very clear in your head. That is why the answers that are coming out are also not very clear. Okay. You are struggling with the answers. You should also feel that. For example, if I'm asking liquidity coverage ratio, it should be in one sentence. You should be able to answer it, and it should be done and over with. You don't have to repeat the same thing again and again. You're repeating because you're not really sure what you're saying.
Yeah.
So that is one. Start working on your basics of banking. If you start making decisions tonight, in the next 2 days, you should have a kitty of 400, 500 good quality questions. So start thinking in terms of questions, and through that start writing questions. For example, you already have access to all the interviews that have been taken offline. You have access to all the interviews that have been taken online, including yours. Everything is being put on OneDrive. Okay. So you can go through them, start writing all the questions that I'm asking. Through those questions, you can keep making more questions also, because I also create questions from questions. Okay. I ask you a question.
Okay, sir.
You are unable to answer it. I create another question out of it. Okay. So the same way, you can keep creating questions. Okay.
Okay.
The first target is have a list of 400, 500 good quality, good questions which are directly related to banking or finance. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
That is your first target. Simultaneously, you can start writing, you can start searching for answers of those questions and start writing those answers. For example, Basel III pillars, it should be very clear, sir, these are the pillars. You don't have to struggle with the questions. When you, let's say, create a list, okay, today for the next 1 hour, I'll be creating questions on Basel only. Okay. And 1 hour spend only on Basel, you create as many questions as possible. Okay. It's not a difficult task. What you need is dedicated time and that kind of a focus that I have to create 500-600 questions in the next 2-3 days. Okay.
That is your target. Okay. Okay.
The resources. I'm giving everybody the resources through those mock interviews. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
And the second task.
Anything else, sir, apart from the.
And the second task that you have to do simultaneously is there were a lot of questions where you were bluffing. Okay. There, it happens with a lot of people, with a lot of students. If they don't know anything, they probably, through intuition or whatever they've read in the past, they feel that whatever they're saying is correct. But at times it is not correct. Okay. So you have to be sure whatever you're saying is correct. For example, CRR, SLR requirements. SLR requirement for payment bank is 75%. They're not 18.25%. It's 75%. Okay. They have to spend 75% of their money in government securities. Okay. So things like that. You might feel that you probably have read it somewhere, or you feel that it should be the same, but it is not. Okay. So there were three, four other instances also where I saw that you were answering something incorrectly but very confident about it. They don't like it.
Okay.
They don't understand that you actually have read something incorrect and you believe it. They feel that you're bluffing.
Okay.
So be very sure whatever you're saying, because bluffing is heavily penalized in the interview at times.
Okay, sir.
So be very sure whatever you're saying is correct. If you're not sure, directly say, sir, I'm not very sure. Okay. So, I'm not like to say anything about it. Answer, especially facts, you have to be sure about them. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, you have to work on two dimensions, create as many questions on banking as possible and simultaneously create their correct answers. And second is, while you're practicing on a daily basis, ask your friends, whoever is taking your interviews on a regular basis to ask you random questions and see if you bluff or not. Okay. And
get it out of the system. Okay, sir.
Chalo, all the very best.
Take care. Good night, sir. Thank you, sir.